There's just something special about your hometown, isn't there? Even if you grow up hating it and move far away, there's just some rare kind of excitement when you go back. I'm telling you, if I could bottle it up and sell it, I would. It's that sense of knowing everything that there is to know. A familiarity, of safety. That priceless, inimitable feeling of knowing what's what.
From above, we see a town.
And then there's Point Hope. That's it right there. Nice, huh? Cozy. But looks can be deceiving.
Parker, hold my hand.
But Mom, I can cross by myself.
Hand, now.
But Mom, I can cross by myself.
They got a library, a mall, and that's your first red flag, because who really has malls anymore? A town hall, cinema, you name it. They got it. They wouldn't rub your face in it, though. Not that kind of people.
Let me get that for you.
Thanks!
Mountains to the left, water to the right, a whole heck of a lot of good people in between.
A townsperson holding a paper grocery bag spots the mayor from across the street.
Mayor Wilson, how are you?
Hey there, Phil. Beautiful day, isn't it?
You can say that again.
A little slice of Americana with an extra helping of apple pie on the side. You don't get any more cookie cutter than here. A population of 23,494.
All of a sudden, a loud screech. In one fell swoop, what can only be described as a winged demon takes the townsperson away. As fast as it came, it's gone. The paper bag of groceries rips open and a single apple rolls across the street, stopping at the mayor's shoes. He picks it up, sighs, wipes it off, and takes a bite.
A population of 23,493.
Parker, you hold my hand right this instant.
No, Mom, I told you I can do it myself.
I can do it myself, see?
A little boy rushes out into the middle of the street. A truck horn blares.
Parker, watch out!
The truck finally stops mere centimeters from the little boy.
Phew, that was close.
Oh, thank God.
She rushes up to her son, fawning over him and making sure that he's okay.
A population of 23...
Just then, another demonic winged creature swoops down and takes the mom. The little boy's face is streaked with blood. He looks down. He's still holding her hand.
You know what? It fluctuates. Point Hope. Ironic name, no? Considering everything the little town has been through. No one knows exactly when it all started, which means it's just long enough for most people to feel like it's always been that way, and others are young enough to not know any different. So, here we are.
Two sailors on their boats waving at one another.
Ahoy!
Ahoy!
A tentacle shoots out of the water, dragging Sailor One to the depths.
Oh boy. I reckon you're wondering why they don't just protect themselves.
The 70s. We see a guy battling a different monster. He grabs a knife and stabs it in the head. It goes down.
I got one!
The people around him cheer.
Thanks. Thanks a whole heck of a lot.
But here's the thing. You can't get better at a game if the other side keeps changing the rules.
During this, we have seen Guy drink at the bar, celebrating with friends. He returns home, changes into pajamas, hears something, looks under his bed. Another monster grabs him and drags him under. We hear teeth gnashing mixed with screams. A younger Mayor Wilson looks up from his paper on the porch next door. Silence. He takes a bite of a pear, goes back to reading. The 80s! A young Girl Scout approaches a door. She knocks.
Yes. Living here makes the little things difficult and the difficult things seem impossible. But humans, like many creatures, have no choice but to adapt.
The door slowly opens.
Would you like to buy some cookies?
A monster stands in the doorway, reaches out. Reaching into her wagon, she opens a box of cookies, pulls out a taser, and tasers the creature until it falls to the ground, spits on it, and then continues her merry little way with her wagon to the next house.
Looking from the outside in, most times you wouldn't know any different. Looks like any other town. Then again, the same could be said for anywhere, I guess.
The 90s. A group of elderly women play cards.
And looks can be deceiving.
One of them puts down a card.
I win again!
Every place is a dark, seedy underbelly. It just so happens that Hope's is a little more...
One of the other old women's eyes glow red, and she launches an attack. There is a tussle which ends with the evil old lady being stabbed in the head with a pate knife.
A parent?
Grandma dusts herself off and sits back down while the other elderly players shudder.
Whose deal?
I know I laid a whole heck of a lot on you, and you probably have questions. But to be frank, things the way that they are right now, you can't really ask them. So we'll have to do this some other way.
Cut to a bunch of children in a classroom. The board behind them has the word elsewhere scribbled on it. All of the kids' hands go up.
Why don't they just leave?
Fabulous question, and one that I get often. That would be the solution, wouldn't it? Just up and leave. Up and leave in a bad situation when things get rough, why not? And early on, folks have tried. But you see, there's this teeny, weeny, tiny little problem.
A mailman, whistling to himself, steps into Point Hope. He hands the resident, who is working on his front yard, a few letters.
Thanks, man.
No problem.
The mailman waves, steps out of Point Hope, and promptly explodes.
Anyone who sets foot in Point Hope can't leave. It's one of the rules, and that one has always been in play.
Why do people go there at all?
Why do people do anything? Everyone has their reasons. You and I understand and said reasons is unimportant.
We see a truck full of eager monster hunters drive in. Then we see someone who is crying, giving up on life, crossing the barrier, arms outstretched, ready to be taken. A worried bystander approaches them.
Hey, you! Are you all right?
The bystander is promptly impaled and falls backwards to the ground.
On!
People are people, after all. One person's intention is another person's mistake.
A mailman rushes up to the two.
You okay?
Leave me alone.
Wow. Okay. Take it easy. Only trying to help. That'll show me trying to help somebody.
The mailman mumbles to himself as he walks away. That's when he steps on a twig. Crunch. He looks down and then to the side. A sign reads, "Now leaving Point Hope."
Shoot.
The mailman explodes.
Why don't they use guns?
Another excellent question. Those things can be hard to come by. They had a system for a while, but...
We see two men in Point Hope yelling at a mailman on the other side of the border. He is holding a package.
Come on, throw it!
Come on!
Are you kidding me?
What are you, chicken?
Just throw it already!
Okay, fine. Here.
The mailman chucks the box of guns over. It hits the ground and one goes off, shooting him. He drops to the ground dead.
Any other questions?
All of the children's hands go up.
Yeah, you. In the back.
Quick zoom. A horrifying demon child who is seething sits at one of the desks. There is blood coming out of its mouth as it gnaws on a child's arm. Perhaps the one that was supposed to be sitting there?
When will they realize that resistance is futile and give up?
You see, that's the unanswerable question, isn't it? I could wager a guess, but...
The sound of gum popping. The whole class turns to see a grown adult man, Alexander Whence, with his feet up on the desk.
I don't know about you all, but this whole lesson is a real drag. I mean, look at this kid. You can't look any more bummed than that. Heck, looking at him has got me depressed. You're like if the song Everybody Hurts had a face, am I right?
You're not supposed to be here.
Alex gives the demon child's back a hefty pat and their arm falls off.
I didn't do it.
Alexander tries to put the arm back on, but it keeps falling off. Eventually, he not so sneakily slides it onto the demon child's desk.
There you go.
You're not supposed to be here.
You said that. I'm not supposed to do a lot of things, kiddo, and yet, here we are. Your arm's still missing, by the way. It's there, right there. Here, let me help.
He reaches out to get it and knocks it on the floor again.
Aw, oh, shit.
Alexander gets on the floor and begins to search for the arm. All of the chairs are now empty, the kids having vanished, so he moves around with ease.
Hey, Teach, a little help? We're falling apart back here.
Just then, a loud, ear-piercing scream. The demon child leaps in the air at Alex. Alexander's eyes widen and close, bracing for impact, but nothing happens. He opens his eyes and sees the demon frozen in midair.
Alexander Whence.
That's my name. Alex, if you're nasty. I don't know why I said that just now. Just kind of came out. Sorry, let's start over. The name's Alexander Whence. Alex, if you're nasty. Shit. Shoot. Wait. Can I curse in this class? Shit. That's a neat little trick you got there. Hey. Where did everybody go? Where are you even? How did I get here? What becomes of the brokenhearted?
All in good time. All in good time.
So that's like, what? 237?
Were you listening?
Never.
When the time comes, you'll know what to do.
So, like, 237?
All right, knock it off. You don't belong here, Alex. Not yet.
Oh, I knew despite that docile tones, you were nasty.
Unbelievable.
So, what now? Is school out or something?
Oh no, Alexander. For you, it's just beginning.
Huh?
What becomes of the broken hearted? Who had love that's now departed? I know I've got to find some kind of peace of mind.
Alexander is blown through the wall by an unseen force as he hurls down toward Earth. Blackness. Music goes from playing on our screens to playing over a grocery store sound system.
Alex?
Alexander's eyes blink open.
If you're nasty.
Stop it.
Oh, okay.
I need you to stock the shelves.
We just stocked them last month.
You see, that's the thing about working at a store. You stock the inventory, and then people purchase said inventory, which means we have to stock it again.
Ah, the great circle of life.
No. Craig, you help him.
Craig pokes his head out from behind one of the aisles. He's currently pretending two celery stalks are his ears.
Sure thing, boss.
Dream team.
Dream team.
They high-five, or at least attempt to. They both miss and pass it off as nailing it anyways. Alex takes one of Craig's celery ears and takes a bite.
Mmm. Hey. Good ear. Fresh. Nice crunch.
I know, right?
Nelson, have you tried the ear in aisle 7?
No!
Both disappear in one of the aisles as they stock.
Ugh, Nelson's a real hard-ass. You know, Craig, this would normally be the part of the conversation where a best friend agrees with me. I must have been going too fast, my bad. Let me start over. Rewind.
Alexander moves backward and through the motions he just went through, trying to get into position like he was at the start.
I'm not going to call Nelson a hard ass, Wince.
Ah, come on, why not?
I don't know, maybe because he's my dad.
Even more of a reason to.
I'm not going to do it.
Come on.
Do you call your dad that?
All of the time, because he is. Come on, just one time. It'll feel real good once you get it out there.
No, I'm good.
Once.
No.
One time.
No.
Real quiet, like, say it. He's a hard ass.
Okay, fine. He's a hard ass.
The manager is behind them. Who is? Craig drops the cans he was holding. The manager looks them up and down, then walks away, leaving them with the mess. Alex pats Craig reassuringly on the back.
Sorry, pal. I guess that's that, then.
What?
You wouldn't react like that if he wasn't one.
The manager peeks back into the aisle. Something to add, Craig? We see the class again. On the board behind them, the phrase, "The rules," is scribbled.
Though the rules in this town are ever-changing, there are some old standbys that you must follow if you want to survive. Evidently, they're the same ones you would find in a game of poker. The good news is Craig Neeley, though not the strongest of players in the game, always abides by one of those rules in particular as if his life depended on it. Mainly because it always has. Fold when you're unsure.
No, sir.
We cut to that evening. The two friends are both sitting at the town's border, sharing a six-pack.
Bud, you need to toughen up, man.
What, like you?
I didn't say it. You did. But yeah.
But there's no one on this planet like you, Whence.
How would we know? We've never been anywhere.
This is fair.
Not really.
Where would you even go?
I don't know. Somewhere. Anywhere. Come on, man. You're telling me you're not bored out of your mind seeing the same people and doing the same things day after day.
A cricket hops from Point Hope into the town beside it. Promptly explodes.
Nah, I'm good.
Well, I'm not. I'm tired of the same thing day after day, week after week, month after month.
The whole "a monster could kill us at any moment" keeps me on my toes.
We fight back.
But there's only so much that we can do. We're not heroes, Whence.
Craig reaches back into the bed of his pickup truck and picks up a newspaper, shows Alex the cover.
These guys, they're the heroes.
We zoom inside of the picture and it comes to life. We're there. Three individuals stand there receiving medals from the mayor. They are James, Alana, and Lucky.
For their valiant display of bravery in the face of true otherworldly adversity, I, Mayor Tim Wilson, present our three heroes with keys to the city.
Well done!
A hero!
Yes! There's a popular little saying I've heard over and over and over again that I feel that I ought to share. Heroes aren't born, they're made. Well, while a lovely little attempt at waxing poetic, this could not be more wrong. It's true, heroes aren't born. But in Point Hope, they're nominated.
We travel through years past. We see civilians getting slaughtered and eaten by every monster and demon imaginable.
At times, it felt like it would never let up. It was like putting a AAA team against a bunch of toddlers. It wasn't pretty. I sure as shit didn't like watching it. But just when everybody thought the game was over, they found their second win in the form of three amulets.
During this time, we've seen four civilians hide in a cave from creatures. As they go deeper and deeper, they stumble upon a box. They open it. Inside are three amulets.
I wouldn't do that if I were you.
Three of them put it on. They are absorbed into their skin.
Are you okay?
One civilian lets out a yell and hits the cave wall, causing a hole through it. Another darts around the area super fast, and when they all turn to look at the third, he has a dead monster in his lap like it was nothing.
Whoa.
These amulets, when put around the neck and absorbed, provide the wearers with supernatural abilities and, most importantly, the power to fight back. But as with most things, there was a catch.
We see the three heroes fighting. They're winning. In the distance, a clock chimes. It is then that a monster's hand goes right through one of the heroes. He dies. The second monster catches on and rips another human apart. The third hero looks at the monster they were fighting and runs away. The monsters give chase, not noticing two amulets on the ground. The third reappears out of the dead hero's skin and joins the pile.
The amulets only work for about 3 years. 3 1/4, to be exact. Well, I guess there's no avoiding this. 69. Okay? 69. The powers last for 69 fortnights. Yes. Even the mystical like to think there's the funniest person in the funniest people in the room. And so, the residents of the town adapted once again, which brings us to another rule. Bring an aggressive posture to the table. Like in poker, once you have a handle on the basics, you need to increase your aggressiveness, even if you have no idea what hand your opponent is holding. Put your money where your mouth is. Too many beginners play too carefully out of fear of losing, but by playing that way, you're really only slowly delaying the inevitable. Bet aggressively, and your opponent will think twice about going head-to-head with you. And sometimes, that pause provides you all the time that you need to win the round.
Thank you. Yeah, it is a pleasure to serve the town that we love.
We are honored and humbled to accept these. It is truly a privilege to...
Every 69 fortnights, three heroes are elected by the town to defend it from what threatens it, or die trying. And then there is everyone else.
The mayor, behind the heroes as they speak, leans over to his assistant, Sophie Thatcher.
Miss Thatcher, it's going to be awfully hard to present the heroes their keys without, you know, the keys.
Right.
Everybody loves a hero, don't they? That's the story that we normally consume like mad at the box office, which is why they keep turning out their superhero films. But isn't everybody the hero in their own story? And if that's the case, does that make each and every one of us the bad guy in somebody else's?
She goes to get the keys and hands them to each hero one by one, Lucky being the last. He seems to absolutely loathe being there. She starts to say something, doesn't, then changes her mind and tries.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thanks.
We've been going through this good guy, bad guy thing for ages. Since the beginning of time. Other countries, other worlds, other workplaces, other high schools, other sandboxes. There are three things certain in life. Death, taxes, and rivalries. I guess at least people are consistent. They'll thrive on a good routine.
Cut. Two, three hands dropping their keys to the city into a growing pile.
And in the end, what does all this matter anyway?
Cut back. Town border with Alex and Craig.
They're okay.
Okay. Whence? These guys are just a year into their heroship, and they're absolutely fucking killing it. Literally. Best we've ever had.
I mean, sure, but...
What? But nothing.
It's not really fair if not everybody gets a shot.
Not this again.
I'm just saying.
Listen, man, you've submitted like 10 times and you've never been picked, not even as an alternate.
I can't help that this town is against me.
I mean, that'll happen when you set an elementary school on fire.
It was cold and it was winter break. Nobody was there.
And when you polluted the town reservoir?
Pond and dump have the same number of letters. It's easy for anyone to get confused.
The park.
If they didn't want you to park there, why name it a park?
Whence? I'm not saying that they're right, but I think they've made it clear the type of folks they're looking for to be their hero. And it's not you. And it's definitely not me.
Yeah. I guess you're right.
For what it's worth, I think you would make one kick-ass hero.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, like, you're very destructive to private property without powers. So I can only imagine what horrors you would unleash on the bad things with them.
Thanks, man.
No problem.
Cheers. Cut to the mayor's office. Sophie stands there, scribbling away.
And I'll need to change my 3 o'clock with Albert to 4:15, then the 3:30 with... Well, wait, who is my 3:30 with? Never mind. Just check my calendar and change it. Then...
Animals need food. Water, space, and shelter to survive. For people, the way to obtain those things is to have a job. To have a job, to express your needs, one needs to be able to communicate. Some folks can talk their way to any reward, whether they deserve it or not. Sophie Thatcher is not one of those folks.
Did you get all of that?
Yes, sir, I did.
Then you'll call the folks down at Francesca's.
Call? Are you sure?
Oh, you know, on second thought, an email might be best.
Oh, thank you.
I thought yesterday went well, didn't you?
I did, yes. Everyone seemed to have a great time.
Excellent. Excellent. Particularly a good batch of heroes this round, wouldn't you say?
I would.
Me too.
You've done a good job.
Thank you. I have, haven't I? I can't remember the time when we've had such a quiet year.
It has been a long time, but with your leadership, I could see even more quiet years ahead.
I appreciate that. You have a good weekend, Miss Thatcher.
And you as well.
Oh, no, not me. A quiet term does not equate a less busy one. Quite the opposite, in fact. It's quite because I'm busy.
A mayor's work is never done.
And without realizing it, Sophie has inhabited yet another one of our rules. Have a consistent strategy. And kissing ass is one of the most foolproof strategies of them all.
The next day, Craig and Alexander are walking through a parking lot toward a mall.
Man, I haven't been here in ages. I didn't even know that people still came here.
I come here.
You don't count.
More than most.
Inside the mall, most of the stores are closed. The two friends turn into a big dog store. A few people mill about.
Well, you'll be a little late. It's fine.
Easy for you to say. You're not the one who leaves work with your boss to go back home to your boss.
You really should move out, you know?
I'm working on it.
Scared to live by yourself?
You live here. Wouldn't you be?
Nah. Commitment, cats with only one eye, the Birch and Swinnerton Dyer conjecture, bees, ventriloquist dummies, cats with two eyes. These things I'm scared of. Living alone, I can handle. I can look out for myself. You can too, bud.
I don't know about that.
It's like they say, Craig. If you can't run with the big dogs...
Stay on the porch. How's it going, gentlemen?
The good doctor appears. An eccentric man that has a tiny pygmy falcon on his shoulder.
Fine, Doc, fine.
Doc?
Yeah, he's a doctor. See?
Zoom in on a crude framed certificate hanging on the wall of the big dog store.
Of what?
Duff! What can I do for you, Alex?
Just swinging by, Doc. Thought I would bring Craig by to see some of the stuff you've got down here.
Ah, playing a little hooky?
You caught us.
I myself used to play hooky in my younger days. Fond memories.
Oh, yeah? When was that?
I don't know.
How old are you now?
See previous response.
Wait, what's the Birch and Swinnerton Dyer conjecture?
Ooh, that is an open problem that attempts to describe the set of rational solutions to equations defining an elliptical curve. Math.
Oh, I keep forgetting he's good at that.
Hey, check this out.
They turn to see that Alex has put on an entire shelf's worth of big dog shirts. He's wearing every single one.
I can't imagine why.
Who's the big dog now?
Oh, say, Alex, did you want to come check out the new merch?
You caught me.
Excellent, excellent. Follow me.
He leads them to the back, setting his tiny falcon down on the register.
All right, you keep a close eye on the floor now, Beatrice.
The bird's going to watch the store? What's she going to do if someone takes something? Hoist them out of here?
Beatrice the pygmy falcon looks directly at the camera like, can you believe this jackass? Breaking the fourth wall. We cut to another shot of the men looking at the falcon, still staring ahead.
What's she looking at?
This way.
The doctor unlocks the back door, and Alex and Craig follow him inside. Down the stairs, deeper and deeper they go.
The good doctor worked at the mall until it all fell 10 years prior, when a titan smashed through, dispersing most of the staff, and what the titan missed, some demons finished up. After it was all over, many decided it was just too much to repair, and they gave up. The good doctor, not being one to give up so easily, decided to set up shop.
A series of cut twos. As we watch the grates of each old shop slide open and the sound of a register ka-chinging.
And shop, and shop, and shop, and shop.
The doctor taking money at a Dick's Sporting Goods. A Spencer's Gifts. A Zoomies, a Sears, etc.
When you're in a town that doesn't give you a whole heck of a lot of promise, you have to make it up for, you gotta make up for in job security.
We find ourselves again in the classroom. Hands shoot up. The board behind them reads, backstory.
But
How does one man run a mall all by himself?
The answer is simple.
One store at a time.
The good doctor works at one store in the mall, and then once all the inventory on that shop is gone, he moves on to the next.
A series of cut-tos. As we watch the grates of each old shop slide open and the sound of a register ka-chinging. The doctor taking money at a Dick's Sporting Goods, a Spencer's Gifts, a Zoomies, a Sears, etc.
And the next, and the next, and the next, and the next. And whenever Alexander Whence would ask him when was the day he would call it quits, without missing a beat, the good doctor would reply,
"It'll be a cold day in hell, and all hope will be lost when you see me in the Clares."
And so he soldiers on. In doing so, he's the living embodiment of our next rule. Be in it for the long haul.
Back at the mall, a light switches on, revealing a dungeon sort of clubhouse. All sorts of pictures and artifacts crowd the space.
Whoa.
You got a bunch of new stuff since the last time I've been by.
Well, you know, I try.
No way.
Way.
Greg turns and comes face to face with a scary sculpture.
Oh, that's a Monongahel. Big in the Philippines. Haven't gotten one of those here yet, but I imagine it's on the way.
Sick.
Sick indeed. It transforms at night and gets bat wings. It can sever its upper body from here to here. It sucks the blood out of sleeping people and pregnant women. Incredibly sexy creature.
Did you say sexy?
What?
You said sexy.
No, I didn't.
You did. I heard you.
Nope.
You did.
Did what?
Say it.
Say what?
That the Monongahel was sexy.
Gross. Whence, your friend is gross. Get away from me, you freak. Monongahel. Sexy. All right, come on.
The doctor walks away and stares longingly at the statue.
He's off his rocker.
Nah, he's just a little out there.
A little?
But that's what makes him so fun.
What part of this is fun?
Hey, Doc, what's this?
Ooh, never fear, though. A little garlic salt and you'll be fine.
Doc?
Huh?
We're talking about something else now.
Oh, right. All right, this here is a real-life vampire hunting kit. Vampire hunters in the 18th century weren't messing around, I can tell you that much.
No kidding.
Yeah, garlic candles, silver bullets, wood stakes, some herbs and vials, like a subscription box of supernatural death. I love a good theme.
Sweet. Doc, you have the coolest shit.
Oh boy, don't I know it.
It really is a lot of stuff. I've never even heard of most of it.
Well, most people haven't. It's a shame, really.
The good doctor eats some herbs out of one of the vials.
I'm telling you, Doc, you need to get the word out about all this stuff.
Well, I did get up on the TikTok. I'm single, if you can believe it. I put up some how-to videos, but then I got flagged for an accidental pronunciation faux pas. I said fellatio instead of loss ratio.
That'll happen.
That it does.
No, it doesn't.
Doc knows everything there is to know about everything supernatural and beyond.
I bet you'd be a big help at the mayor's office. Why aren't they working with you?
The good doctor freezes, turns to face the wall, his back to them.
Oh, yikes.
What? What did I do?
The past, it's a tricky thing. And it's made even trickier when you're stuck in the same place and can't leave it behind. And the mayor and the good doctor were doomed from day one.
Cut two. A baby Mayor Tim Wilson, wearing the same outfit as the adult Mayor Wilson, and a baby Doctor Good, wearing the same outfit as the adult Doctor, play together in a sandbox. Baby Doctor reaches out with his shovel and smashes the baby Mayor's sandcastle. Cut back. The Doctor turns back out to face the group.
Let's go back upstairs, shall we?
They do.
Well, it's been a pleasure seeing you boys.
Same here, Doc.
No, stop by anytime.
I'll hold you to that, you know.
For as long as I have a place for you to visit, you are welcome.
The sound of glass shattering, a scream, the three rush out into the mall hall to see flying demons attacking the civilians inside. It is anarchy.
Well, shoot. On a weekend, too.
As long as we stay in here, we should be okay.
A crash. A flying demon breaks into the big dog store, causing everyone to scatter.
You both stop saying things because they're just going to do the opposite of what we want.
The group hurries and ducks behind a bench.
Oh, no. What do we do? What do we do?
Do you see that light up there?
He points to a blinking light up by the ceiling. Every 15 feet, there's another one. They are all going.
Someone pressed the hero call button. They should be on their way.
How long will that take?
Not very long. They're pretty quick about it. Strange, though.
What?
I didn't push it, so who did?
A severed arm drops from above. In its clutches, it holds a black remote control labeled Heroes.
Oh.
We can't just hide here all day.
Speak for yourself.
We have to fight back.
With what? Retorts?
I mean...
No, no. Don't even think about it.
Doc, do you have anything?
Do I have anything? I've got nothing.
We can make a run for it. Maybe it's not that bad.
They all peek out. It's bad, really bad. One patron is being dragged by their hair.
Let go! Let go! Let go! Let go! Let go!
The three sink back down.
We're screwed. We've got nothing. This is it. This is the end. Game over, man. Game over.
Good movie.
Just then, a baseball bat drops into Alex's lap. He looks up and sees the doctor's pygmy falcon looking at him.
Game on.
Alexander steps out with the bat raised.
Come and get me, fuckers!
A demon races at him, and Alex gives a mighty swing, sending it flying.
Oh, nice!
Another demon swoops past, and Alex connects, sending it into the fountain. Alex walks over and keeps hitting it until it's dead.
Get him, Whence!
Another flies toward him, and he hits it, sending it flying into the wall.
Touchdown!
Follow me, guys. We're getting the fuck out of here.
The two get up and do so, as Craig walks by Beatrice.
Smart bird.
The pygmy falcon looks directly at the camera again, as if to say, duh, idiots.
Get away from me! Leave me alone! Somebody help!
What makes somebody a hero?
It's hard to say. To wit, how long is somebody a hero for? And if you were a hero, and nobody but your two friends were around to see it, did it really happen?
A demon flies by and picks Alex up by the bat, throwing him through a store window, which breaks, separating him from the doctor and Craig.
Fuck! That hurt! This can't get any worse.
He forces himself back up just as the lights in the mall go out.
Damn it! I did it to myself.
Blinking emergency lights go on, illuminating the space every once in a while. Alex walks through it on high alert.
You would think, being brought up in this world, Alexander Whence would have been prepared for a situation like this one. You would think that he would know where his limitations lied. Things are meant to bend, but if you bend them too far, they're going to break. You would think that in this moment, he was up shit creek without a paddle.
As he walks, we see a demon behind him growing closer and closer.
You would think that...
The demon is poised to attack, but then a shelf comes crashing down onto it. Alex turns to see Sophie Thatcher standing there as the lights continue to blink on and off. Cut to the classroom. The board now reads, "Now introducing." Sophie is seated at one of the desks. No stutter.
You'd be wrong.
Who are you?
The paddle, I think.
Back at the mall.
Who are you?
Who are you?
I asked you first.
I asked you last.
Screams.
Let's just get out of here, okay?
Okay.
They do. They find the good doctor and Craig.
Whence? You're okay.
Yeah, I'm fine. Almost bit the dust in there, but managed to Whence my way out of it. Sorry, Doc. Looks like you're going to have to close Charlotte Russe.
Oh, that's fine. I didn't know what they did there anyways.
The group moves through the mall as quietly as they can manage. Destruction surrounds them.
When this is all said and done, Doc, I'll help you clean this place up.
Well, I appreciate that, Alex.
You're Mayor Wilson's assistant, yeah?
You're the grocery store owner's son, yeah?
Alex, what now?
Gang, we have a problem.
They all peek out from around the corner to see a giant demon standing in front of them, blocking their path.
Get her!
They all do. The demon and its friends give chase.
It is true that Alexander Whence did not approve of the hand that he was dealt, and who could blame him?
A demon corners Craig.
How many times have we wanted something that's completely different than what was handed to us at the start?
A demon corners the good doctor, who grabs a hold of his pygmy falcon and hides behind her. She looks directly at the camera as if to say, "Can you believe this shit?"
And no matter what we did, we couldn't do anything to make it any better.
A demon corners Sophie.
But sometimes, them's the breaks.
A demon corners Alex.
And sometimes, we just have to accept that other times there are other folks better equipped with better hands to deal with the current situation.
Hey, you!
The demon turns to see James, Alana, and Lucky at the ready.
All of you, back off!
The demons leave the group and head toward the heroes, where a battle royale breaks out. The doctor, Sophie, Alex, and Craig all find their way back together.
What now?
Scatter!
Scatter!
Again?
Sophie and Alex go one way, Craig and the doctor another.
It's like I said, sometimes there are those who are meant for great things, and the rest of us, well, we're destined just to get by and to have to resign to that fact.
Back in the classroom, there are 6 desks. Alex sits in one, Sophie sits in another, Craig in one, the doctor in one, and Beatrice the Falcon in another.
No offense, but this is a shit lesson.
I second that.
Thirded.
Excuse me?
It doesn't seem very helpful to tell your students that they've reached their limit before they even get started. If that's the case, why even try at all?
Exactly.
Craig notices the 6th empty desk.
Someone's missing.
No, not exactly. Who decides what things are great? Who gets to be great? You? Them? The folks down there? How is that even fair? Why are we giving people we don't even know the power to make those kinds of calls? They don't know me. They don't know us. Heck, I just met you, but you seem okay.
Thanks. I just met you and you seem... you.
Thanks.
Whose desk is that?
I haven't spent a single second of my life worrying about what folks thought about me, and I'm not going to start now.
Me either.
Me either.
Someone else is supposed to be here.
Back at the mall, the fight is brutal, but the gang watches as the heroes take the lead.
Sometimes things seem so cut and dry, don't they? Black and white, more or less.
Whew. Good going, gang. We did it.
Good work, Lucky.
Yeah, thanks.
But the thing about Point Hope is that you've already learned is, while there are some standbys, the rules are always changing.
More demons come. We see James fighting.
That was supposed to be the guy.
James dies.
That was supposed to be the girl.
Alana dies.
And
that was always supposed to be me.
Lucky is left fighting by himself. He's getting overwhelmed. Alexander turns back to watch him.
Come on! We have to go!
Alex looks between his friends and Lucky. He sees the amulet seep out of the deceased James's chest. Looks back to Lucky, then the demons. Then Alex notices a discarded phone on the ground. It's ringing. The time on it is lighting up. 2:37.
Well, I'll be damned.
Alex makes a mad dash toward the amulet. Lucky notices.
No. What are you doing? What are you doing?
Alexander puts the amulet around his neck. A light surrounds him as it melts into him. It is on.
Rule numero uno. Defense.
Alex fights alongside Lucky. everyone watches. He's kicking total ass.
Holy shit, he did it.
As great as he and Lucky are doing together, they're still outnumbered. Sophie pokes her head out from close by Alana's body. The amulet is close.
Take it! Put it on! Do it!
After a moment of deliberation, Sophie reaches out for the amulet, takes it, stands up, and is about to put it on when a demon takes it out of her hand. It crashes to the ground across the room and shatters, melting. It's done for.
Oh, no, 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 no. Damn it!
Alex and Lucky continue to fight. Somehow they manage to pull off a win. Nothing short of a miracle. Quiet. And then...
That was fucking awesome!
People died. My friends died!
Oh. Yeah. Yeah. It was awesome, right?
Hiding behind an orange Julius stand that's on fire, Craig gives a little thumbs up. Later, the gang sits in the destroyed food court. A crowd has gathered, including the mayor.
I had to be here to believe it. Alexander Whence, I knew you were in trouble from the day I met you, but now...
Hey, now he's your problem for the next 3 years.
Come again?
Yeah. Jean-Claude Van Dammit here put on the amulet.
He didn't.
He did.
He didn't.
He did.
I did.
He did. He did.
He did. Oh, no. Yeah. And then this one over here, she ended up somehow...
I don't... Saving the day as well. Put on the amulet? She had no other choice. We would have been lost without her.
Is this true, Sophie?
Sophie doesn't feel so great about this last rule.
It's true?
Bluff.
Anything to add, Lucky?
Maybe later.
Well, if that's the case, and it appears to be, then I suppose I'm shit out of luck then, hmm? Well, we all are. If this is our new team of heroes, may God be with us. Lord knows he hasn't been up until this point. Why should that change now?
Mayor Wilson goes to leave, sees the good doctor. Both stare at each other for a moment. Good doctor turns to face the wall, and the mayor leaves.
I'm gonna need a new assistant.
Later, the group is walking toward the exit of the mall.
You lied. The amulet was destroyed.
We'll worry about it later.
Yeah, that's your life motto, isn't it?
Am I that easy to read?
Yes.
You're gonna get her killed.
Listen, we don't want people to panic, and you know that's exactly what they'll do if they find out. That's the last thing this town needs. They've lost hope in so much. They don't need to lose it with their three heroes. There has been three. There will always be three, and trust me, the last thing you want is to deal with me all on your own.
Well, I guess on the bright side, I've already served a year and a half. I've only got about another year and some change until I'm all done.
What? Oh, no. It's 3 years consecutively. It has to be the same team. This isn't vacation time. You don't get a grace period. Time doesn't carry over. What? Nobody told you?
Lucky is now throwing things in the mall, yelling as he does so. Getting out a lot of anger. Cut to the classroom. The gang is all sitting there. The board behind them reads, roll call. Lucky enters in a huff, plops down at the empty desk, pouting.
Told you we were missing somebody.
Shut the fuck up.
Back in the real world, we watch the gang reach the front of the mall. They open the doors and step outside.
So, there you have it. That's Point Hope in a nutshell as it stands at the current moment. Think that I covered everything. Got pretty good at this over time. If you have any questions, I don't think you were listening too closely because we covered it all. But now the question isn't what Point Hope is. It's where it's going. And I don't have the answer for that. Maybe we'll come up with it together. We'll just have to see.
Do you hear that?
What?
That voice doing a Wonder Years type narration thing, except really sad.
Nah, I hear it.
I hear it too.
Yep.
I'm going to be honest. I'm still not very clear on the rules here.
Yeah. Sometimes life is just like poker. But if all the tips I gave you don't work out, understand that sometimes you're just stuck in that position of having to play the hand you're dealt. Is that really all that bad?
Our heroes in the mall parking lot. Cut to classroom. The bell rings. It is empty. The door is open as if all of the students ran out. The board reads, Cliffhanger. Cut back. Our heroes see a large crowd of dark, ominous figures approaching through the fog.
Oh, shit!
Cut to black. End of episode.